Welcome to WFTDA on Twitch. I'm your host, Chloroform Cupcake, and you're watching Upon Review. I'm excited to share this new program with you. This is only our second episode, so thank you so much for tuning in to us. Upon Review is a show dedicated to looking back on a game and seeing what happens with the teams that played the game. So you'll have an inside view and opinions from the people that were there. So today we're going to be watching from the 2019 International WFTDA Playoffs hosted in Montreal, Canada. And that was hosted by New Skids on the Block and the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. We're going to bring you Game 11, and that's the matchup between Montreal's New Skids on the Block and Philly Roller Derby Liberty Bells. So let's go ahead and get this party started. Today, to join me in this review of this awesome matchup from Philly, we're going to start with Philly, is Jail Bars, V-Diva, and Reptar. So how y'all doing, Philly?
Good, good. Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Thanks for being here.
We have something to do.
All right. And then joining us from Montreal is Biggley, Smallz, Patricide, and Labrosse. How are you doing today, Montreal?
Great. Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, thank you for being here. Yay. So now that we all have you on screen, this game, and then this point in time, I'm going to go ahead and set the stage for everybody. It was around 4.5 months ago. I know it feels like forever since we've seen some derby. So what I was doing is actually producing this very game. So I remember all of the excitement that was happening. Year two leagues, we recently saw you at playoffs going back and forth. It was just phenomenal derby. So everybody was looking forward to seeing this go down. I'm sure all the brackets at this point were busted in going into game 11. So we're going to go ahead and talk about a little bit where you were all at. We'll go ahead and start with you, Philly. Where were you as far as the game start? Were you a pit, a blocker? Were you in the hot tub getting ready to go out for jam two? What were your positions?
So
go ahead and start with you, Bars.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Yeah, I'm Jail Bars. I'm a blocker and primarily a brace.
I'm Diva. Hi, everyone. I was a pivot and a blocker. I guess it's the same thing.
And a jammer.
Oh, yeah, you should do that too. Surprise.
I need it.
I'm a jammer primarily, so it's probably for the best. I'm not a great blocker, but Reptar.
Nice. Thanks, Reptar. And then Montreal, let's start with you, Biggs.
I'm Biggley Smallz. I am primarily a blocker. Only a blocker, actually.
Next we have Patricide.
I am Patricide. I don't think any.
Oh, we can kind of hear you. We've been having some issues, but that's okay. Patricide, you were the coach, the A, I believe. Is that correct? Just nod your head. Yeah. Okay, great. And then go ahead. Labrosse. Oh, we lost Labrosse's mic. Did you accidentally hit mute? Because that happens to the best of us. Nope. Just refresh your page. I'll introduce you. That's Labrosse. JB is up there right above you. Okay, yeah, you can see everybody. Okay, so yeah, so Labrosse is a blocker primarily. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so now that we kind of have the stage started, let's go ahead and get the game pulled up here. At this time, Philly, you were ranked 8th in the WFTDA. Montreal, you were 9th. And that had been the case for a little bit. You two were formidable opponents for one another. Playoffs earlier in the year was just awesome sauce. So historically, Philly, you'd been leading the records of win in the matchups. Because I think this would have been your 8th matchup total. But we were on Montreal's home turf. So it really came down to like a game plan for either squad. I mean, mean, Montreal, you did have the home team advantage. Philly, you had a lot to prove. You were running up the ranks, going from, I believe it was 22nd position in the WFTDA, all the way up to 8th. And so now I want to ask you, Philly, maybe D.Va, what was your game plan going up against Montreal?
Our game plan was basically we play them at playoffs, and then going into champs, like, it was, we played them for so many years and their talent is very strong, but we did a lot of like VRs is one of our back people that their strategy and like breaking down videos and stuff for when we go into the games that we play against them. But like, it's really, really hard. We like, they're good. They're a good team. So we did a lot of studying and, you know, it was still came down to what it is.
Nice. And then I'll throw the same question to you, Montreal. Let's try to get you up there, Pat. Did you have a strategy going into facing Philly?
I'm just going to try to speak to see if anyone can hear me.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Sorry about that. Having some problems with my setup. I think for we knew there was a strong possibility we would face Philly at playoffs. So I'm sure they're in the similar boat that we probably did a lot of the prep prior to playoffs. And so going into, I think we did a bit of reviewing that game and then going back to our game plan for it.
Nice. And we were all talking together about how people were, you know, do footage reviews and things like that. Have either of you watched this game over since that play? They're Philly,
yes,
Montreal.
A lot.
Yeah.
Awesome. So this will be fantastic. Did you have something to say, Biggs?
No, it's cool. It's cool.
Throw it in there. The people want to know.
Yeah. Well, I myself, I like to watch a lot of footage. I repeat things because I just want to learn how to get better from some things. I work from home. Before it was cool, you know? So like I often watch games frequently and I'll watch it like slow-mo. I like to see where to improve, and I can never watch I can't watch it just once because I won't learn enough from it, because I'm normally focusing on myself on the first time where I'm like, oh, I'm garbage. So I've definitely watched this game a lot just to see what collectively Philly was doing very successful and what we can improve on as well and where our successes are. So I watched a lot. That's not what I was saying.
All right, go ahead, bro. Oh, nope, still can't hear you. Aw, bro had something cool to say.
Oh, wait, we can hear you now.
We can hear you now.
Oh, you can.
Oh.
I'll just use the computer. Oh, okay. I can't hear you guys well. One more thing that I thought was interesting is this was my third season with Montreal, and historically we've had the worst end of our seasons, like Biggley, you know, like the last game after that, we haven't finished strong. So like one, we're focusing on Philly, but what we're focusing on is like being proud of ourselves at the end of the season. Cause like, I mean, I joined the team the second year we were trying to make it to champs. And so it was like kind of a pattern that we were trying to break for ourselves to like not to end the season on a high note. So we had like two separate kind of targets, like, you know, we were focusing on ourselves too, because it just sucked the like previous 2 years we'd all like have our last game and just like not feel as proud as we could have about what we left on. So as Bigley was talking about that, I was like, oh yeah, we did really focus on that. So that was part of our prep as well.
Nice. That's a really good point, because you know, a lot of people, they say that we're gonna watch footage. The cool thing about both of your teams is that you had footage like maybe a month old to watch and review, so that was pretty specific. So I mean, we knew this was going to be a really good matchup. So now that we have this like the stage completely set up, we're gonna go ahead and get the footage rolling here. And if you're watching from home, please, on our Twitch feed, our chat room is open. If you have a question or a comment for your amazing friend here on the screen, we'd be happy to get that out to them. We'll field your questions and reactions here in the commentary. So we're going to start this game. It's going to be about 30 seconds coming up. Does anybody have any sort of feels going into the start? Like, what did that feel for you, maybe? Bars, did you have any sort of, like, focus going into that start?
Yeah, so, and like you mentioned, we had played Montreal in playoffs, like, a couple of months before, and that was, we lost that one. So we all definitely really wanted to come out strong, and we knew what to expect. But so I think that's kind of where we all were. Like, we knew it was, like, our last game of the year and our last game of the season. And, you know, we were hoping to, like, really change it up and take the win.
Very, very point. One of the announcers was saying, you know, Montreal at this point, you know, you had three championships in a row that you have, so you were a little bit fresher with the Philly. You have the experience and the history behind it. What did it feel like, Montreal, going against a more veteran team like Philly, knowing that this was, they have a lot to prove? They had a really hard 4 year going into this game. I'll give the question to you, bro.
Yeah, can you hear me okay?
Sorry. Yes.
Yes. Okay. Well, like, I mean, we knew, we studied Philly a lot and we knew how badly they wanted it. And we know, like, the playoff game that we played was so, I mean, every time I've played Philly, it's been so brutal. So we know how, like, tough they are. So I think, like, knowing, you know, sometimes the cliche of, like, whoever wants it, we were like, we don't, it's hard to say because we also, like, our lens was how much the league had, like, had come together and, like, how much we wanted to do, like, our best, like, not to say thank you to the league, but just to show them, like, their months of work. Like, we didn't take for granted, like, the main event going on. So I think, like, we just knew Philly was going to bring it. Like, obviously, you have, like, fire in you if you try to, like, because of our previous game. So I think we just, now I forget my question, but we didn't take it for granted how tough this game would be and how we'd have to play to the very end. And, like, as you'll see soon, we don't come out with our best start. And I think, like, it's been seasons of us building, like, a mental game to not care about the score. And so that's why this game is really, like, awesome to watch, because you see, like, the grit from everybody, like, from the start. And obviously there are, like, so many nerves going on because it's, like, last, you know, it's the last game of the season. And yeah, I'll stop because I'm rambling. Yeah.
No, that's all right. Actually, you mentioned this is a huge, gritty game. And that's exactly true. I mean, this first start was really tough. We're going to get an official timeout here. This first jam was just like, we're saying it was like a minute 30 before, I believe Scar2B got the lead jammer position. And actually, this is a Philly review. Philly, you were playing this really like, if you had a rule book out and you were like, I'm going to check, did you have someone on the sideline double checking and making sure and watching all the rules go by? Because you're going to have this official review right here. And you're going to call that. And it was, it ended up being an in sub for Scar to beat you. So what was your strategy behind that? Were you just trying to throw them off their mental game?
So we were warned to notice, I don't know, whatever the official term is, like, to not skate through on the, if you look at the bench and the ref lane, to not skate through where that red tape is. And yeah. So that was, it was just really fresh. And I, like, as Scar2 was going to the box, we, like, saw that they skated through it. And that was what the review was. It was just really,
yes, not on my watch was what we saw. It was like, I remember seeing this and I was producing the game before the announcers that were live on this feed. I was, we were like, oh snaps, they're coming and they are coming hard. So we really try to set a precedent for how this game is going to run. Biggs, how did your team react to this?
Well, you know, it was a silly, it's kind of that silly penalty that we are, oh, damn it. But after that, we definitely kept in mind going forward. you know, I'm glad we got it out of the way at right at the beginning, you know? So, yeah, it did kind of shake us a little bit. Like Bro was saying at the beginning of the game, it was definitely a little bit more of a struggle. So that probably added to it, you know? So good on Philly. You got that call. That was smart. So I'm here for it.
I mean, it wound up to, I think Montreal is the same a few later, like a couple jams later. So we kind of evened out on that one.
Yeah. I feel like we're okay. So two teams that both have high level refs as their bench coach staff to wear the A. So.
Yeah. So right now in the Twitch feed, people are, you know, they think this is so cool. You are coming together to watch this game. Have you worried about any strategies to each other? I mean, this was 4.5 months ago, and then also, you know, our roller derby season is, you know, hit or miss right now. How do y'all feel about that? I'll throw that to whoever wants to answer.
So sorry, for the strategies going into towards the game.
Yeah.
Sorry, you're a little choppy on that. So it was mostly like working on where, like, what we were doing well in the first game. We had the luxury of playing them not too long ago, so wanted to see what we capitalize on and where we can improve. So like Bro and I were both saying, is we studied ourselves, we studied them, and we just tried to correct it. There's no point in coming up with crazy new stuff when you only have a month where you can just correct your errors going in. So that was a huge focus for us, I know.
Nice. Yeah, I agree. Right now, if you're watching us, the official timeout here that's happening is due to blood on the track. So I'm going to clean that up and time out. But look at this replay here. Defensively, Carol, you were doing so well watching those lines. When we go into jam number three, though, Billy, you're going to showcase this really strong defense, and you're going to start the jam three like a wall. And I wanted to know, like, what your line of thinking was as far as, you know, setting up your start. Do you have start plans against them? Like, would you have a playbook ready to go, or was this all kind of just instinctively, we're going to go with the flow here? I'll throw it to you, Reptar.
So our, like, we have a strategy off the line specifically for the team.
Mm-hmm.
Cut out a little bit, sorry.
Yes.
So I think a lot of strategy with lining up on the line is what wall are we working with and what jammer are we working with, because we kind of have different relationships, jammer in each wall, that we know each other really well and what works for each one. So it usually depends on that. And the furthermore we get game, like what's been working for, like maybe against another jammer, we kind of just like pick and play with those relationships we have with our own blockers versus who we're going against and what's working.
Oh, so that's interesting. So you had stick starts depending on the wall, not necessarily the jammer on the trail.
Like with our own.
Okay, yeah, that's great.
Like, to make a plan, like with our jammer.
Yeah. Oh, that's perfect. Yeah, because like right now we're seeing you line up pivot line, and was that specifically because, you know, Carol had a skater down? They were playing 3 versus 4.
Yeah, so usually we'll try to do that. Again, it's so we do our jammer preference, and then as we get into the game, and if something is more successful versus a specific jammer, we try to do that and build that into our plan. But seeing it as only the third jam, you know, we're trying to feel stuff out. But sometimes when we have the pack at the blocker advantage, we will try to take the front so that we can, you know, like, smother them a little bit more from start.
I think a challenge for coaches and players both is you're like so focused on what's working and looking for your own team, you're paying attention on what you're not working.
That's a good point too there. What we're going to see here as we go into this further, Philly, your defense was doing such a great job at bridging and drawing back. The announcers and the crowd and people on Derby Twitter were really in support of seeing this happen on a regular basis. Like, you're very consistent with it. What was your drill? Like, did you have drills or did you have practices specifically for this drawback method that you were using during this game? I'll throw this to you, Diva.
Yeah, we just repeat stuff at practice on things that we need to work on and what things that didn't work during games. Like, for example, we took from our first game against Texas and apply it to this game, but also taking from playoffs. So we really like study on what jammer we have, what blockers we have, what ball, and we will just repeat and repeat drills after drills at practice. But it's awesome that people are thinking. I think for us, we feel like can improve more and more and more. So I think from watching this video, I think that we can improve a lot more than we're, but it's awesome that it worked. So.
And then, you know, Montreal, what did you do to like recalibrate? You were talking about how you did a little bit more of like, we're not going to look at the score, you know, it takes 10 minutes off the clock. So you won't get any score on the board for Montreal until about 20 minutes on the game clock. What was your strategy as far as, you know, not, you know, you, we know you're not looking at the game score or the clock at this point. What were you doing to try to counterbalance Philly's defense? I'll throw it to you, Biggs.
So for us, when we get chaotic, it's when we start to lose control of the speed of the game. So in that moment, I know that our line specifically, I'm sure all of our team was doing this, but our focus was to control speed. So that was a lot of communication, a lot of slowing it down, locking it down, less like big hits, trying to control the momentum, you know? So because we didn't get that at the beginning, we had to like really work towards getting that. And that was definitely our focus.
It definitely pays off because by the end of this half, what we'll see is we think it's a tied game, or I'm sorry, a 1-point game. So, you know, this game definitely develops. And I think with that strategy in mind, I think what we'll see is how that pressure really didn't phase too much to Montreal. Montreal, you did a great job of just hanging in there and playing your game. But Philly, your defense was just so uproarious. Like, people were losing their minds on the internet and in the crowd. So did you have any feels at this point in the game? Because what ends up happening here is that Montreal, you hit a lot more penalties than Philly does. And in fact, most of your penalties are from your jammers. Pat, how did you feel? Like, what were you seeing on the bench to get Montreal back in the focus?
I mean, I think at this point, like, you can see the score. We haven't put any points on yet, but at the same time, we've had like 3 jammer penalties in the first 4 jams, so obviously it's kind of hard to score points without jammers. So I think we're trying to focus on kind of getting control of that, keeping our players on the track and just sort of weighing this out and waiting for the opportunity.
Very good. And like a attempted apex
jump. Distracted
jump.
By that instant replay.
Yeah. That was a great look there. We have some people in the chat room loving the bout makeup from Miracle Whips. And a couple of, you know, things that they really enjoy the sports personship in this game. Reptar, you're jamming here and you pick up that lead jammer position very quickly. How are you feeling at this point in the game? I know it's only like 9 minutes in, but you seem to have a comp about yourself and your defense that's just blowing it up. Your defense is fantastic point in the game.
Well, since you reached the end of your sentence, I'm mad that I'm in the box at this point, but before that, I think it was just like at that point pretty electric to be like in the lead by with more so it was about the momentum and that we just felt that we really like pulling out every jam off. It was definitely felt like we had a lot to make up for because we were missing at that point. Another jammer companion of mine, Herman Monster, was out with a hurt shoulder. So I think in like my position, I felt like we just really had to come out there with a lot of fire and make up for that, what we were missing there. So it kind of makes you rise to the occasion.
Yeah, nothing like a penalty to like give you some more ammo to the track, right? We have a question for Rage, and they asked, you know, this game looks like Montreal favor the three walls and one dedicated offense, and Philly favor the heavier defense with four from line. Was that the plan? So Philly, was that the plan to kind of keep four together and maybe break off in pairs? And then I'll ask Montreal the second part of the question.
So we have a couple of different steps, but we normally try, and it depends, but we normally try to do three blockers together with a dedicated O. Sometimes we keep four on defense to make sure we have a catch on a jammer, and then send a delayed O. So again, it kind of depends on the situation.
All right, and then Montreal, you know, do you favor the three walls with one dedicated offense person?
Yeah, I think so. I think like Biggley. Oh, sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah.
We can hear you. Okay, sorry for asking that. Like Biggley was saying, I think especially with a score like this, our job breaks down and kind of go back to like basics. Like I don't want to say basics, but like. We practiced all year playing with like having two people separate. But I think because, you know, we're down by quite a bit, we just need to like Biggley said, like slow it down. We're not a team that wants to fast, and we're not like, I think Philly is like definitely more like physical than we are. Like it's not necessarily our game. So instead of trying to like, you know, everybody do offense and like abandon what we're comfortable at, we tried to bring it down. So especially now, you'll see a lot of like right now, Caddy's like there's 1-0 and we're trying to slow things down. So definitely for us, it's not the time to like experiment. So we're trying to kind of stick to what we know we can like control to get to where we get. And we'll see if things change up a little bit. I don't really remember, but yeah, this is definitely where we're most comfortable. Like, so that's what we're doing the most right now.
Heck yeah. It's paying off in the long term. And you just big scoring down previously, so you're now officially on the board. You know what I'd love to do is, because we're starting to get into the nitty-gritty of things, is pause the video here at 17 minutes and about 30 seconds, and we're just going to refresh our feed so that our viewers at home can kind of, we'll just refresh everything so that our audio and everything stops being so choppy. So if everybody wants to hang out with us, we're just going to do a quick reset here. Okay, thanks. Welcome back to Upon Review. I'm Cora from Cupcake. We just took a quick break to reset the feed. We heard you in the chat room, and hopefully this works. If not, we're going to have one heck of a game until halftime. So thank you for sticking around and dealing with the amazing things that we got going on here. Really quickly, we're going to pull up our game right back where we left off at 17:45, around there. We just noticed that, you know, at this point, you haven't been talking much, so we're going to throw you a question. What was the plan regarding your position? I mean, we know that you can jam, but this whole game, we see you in blocking mode. And so what was your game plan going into this particular game with Montreal? Diva?
Oh, I didn't know what was go to. Could you repeat it?
Yeah, no problem. So, like, there was a lot of chatter among, because we know how this game kind of plays out, but everybody, especially the announcers, were mentioning how you'd only jammed one jam the entire, you know, game so far and your time in the season. So, what was the plan going into face all as far as your position was concerned?
As well, not a jammer not anymore, but
yeah,
it was all news to me. Our managers, a prior jammer, end up getting hurt in a game prior, but this, you know, like, I'd rather been blocking, but it was, I don't know, I'll do it, I'll jam, you know, but I'd rather be blocking. It's well, hard. It's definitely a different too. Game.
I'm gonna throw that out there. Yeah, so Herman, like Herman Monster got hurt in the game against Rose, and she's one of our other primary scorers, so V-Diva stepped in and we utilized her mostly when there was a blood blocker advantage. So yeah. You'll see a couple times she jams, like Montreal has two blockers out there, so.
Nice. Very strategy based. That's a good call. Back to the game. We are seeing a huge run out from Montreal catching up the score. And we have a lot of the crowd just reacting like insanely. They're very excited for this. Philly, you take a timeout here. Was this to freeze Montreal's, you know, comeuppance? Is this the a freeze mode, or were you trying to reset? Was there a plan at this point? I'll throw the question to you, Reptar.
I think it was probably just a momentum switch and like to check back in, if I remember correctly, because we did just have that jam where, you know, we didn't have a jam just then. So it's kind of just like stop, reset, calm down. If I remember right, is that how y'all remember it? No, no.
Yeah, I think it was a good time to, like, take a beat and settle ourselves down. And since we were playing in Montreal, you know, like, the crowd was awesome and fantastic and for Montreal. So, so I think, you know, like, they started to really, like, settle into their game. And we just wanted to kind of try and pause, take a breath, and reset.
That was a very good call. Something I think most coaches would probably throw out there here. And now Falcon Punch on this jam here, was this part of your plan there, Pat, to have Falcon Punch do like a defensive jamming off the start, or was Falcon Punch just like amped to go?
I wouldn't know what her plan was going on the track in that case. It's kind of like other people who are managing the jammers, and everyone's kind of got their little role on the bench. To be honest, I don't think I usually know what they're planning on doing. I don't know what if that was a Biggley might have a better answer for this one.
Yeah, go ahead.
So this was our line. I know that Falcon did talk about doing like a little bit of defense off the start, just so, because it will buy us time, you know. It did end up being successful. She was able to get like right out, but you know, doing a little jammer defense here and there is good, because they were obviously in the first quarter of this game, they were in leads, and we weren't, and that's what we needed to switch the focus to. So that bought us enough time to get that lead. Although, did she get her lead? Did she get a penalty? No. Yes, she did. Okay.
Yeah, it was a very quick jam. Yes, now we're on the next jam here. Philly, you're starting to pull up here a little bit in the score. We had, during our break, huge shout out in the chat room to Magnum PEI, to giving a dance party to everybody. We're glad you're all back asking questions. Magnum also wants to give a shout out to you, Biggs, for you and your coconut. How is Jake doing, though?
He's hiding now. He had no interest in this. I'm so sorry. He'll probably be back second half. He's second half in the gas.
For those watching at home, Jack is Biggs' cat. So, yeah, let us know what your pets are thinking about the game. We don't have any more questions necessarily from the chat room. Just a lot of love for both of you, your leagues coming in and, you know, watching this game together. We are now at 13:57, pausing here. The score is 24-41. Montreal we have Kyle Kenzie on the jam line, a huge Derby Twitter person who's also awesome. Kyle Kenzie had some real big moves going into this game. I'm wondering, you know, when I think Philly did do a change in the jam rotation, but Montreal, did you kind of keep pretty close to yours the entire game? I'll throw it to you, Pat.
For the jam rotation, yeah, we typically have a plan that we communicate with the team ahead of time about how we're rotating different jammers. They kind of have different roles. And I think, I honestly, I haven't rewatched this game since jams. I don't remember, but I think we kept pretty fluid in the rotation. We have people who go out more frequently, people that go out a bit less, but it's kind of even track time, I think, across the five of them, or at least across those two groups. We just try to match them up with the blockers that they're best suited with.
Very cool. Yeah, and so here, as we're going through this jam here, Reptar, you're jamming. How is it feeling against Montreal's defense at this point?
I wasn't having a great time, to be honest. They're hard balls. I mean, they'll do a good job. And the worst ones are whenever you get all the way out and there's just like one person left, and you're just like, that's one of those moments. It's usually you, Biggley. I hate it. So good on you.
I just get thirsty for those hits, man. Gets me in trouble too much though, too. So,
did you two just best friends?
BFFs.
We're already friends.
I don't know how to do that heart thing, but you get it.
I saw that. Yeah.
I have a thing.
Yes, go ahead.
So since you mentioned Kenzie, I find one of Kenzie's like strengths, if you watch her jam, is like she doesn't really phase. Like if she can go out and like, I don't know if you guys agree, but like she could have gone out five jams and like not gotten a single point. And then the next time she goes out, she can like do laps around people. Like she did it like her against Rose 1 year. And like, anyway, so I think it's just like, I'm sure Philly's like this too, you know, like they're saying with D.Va, like you figure out who's like who to put when. So it's really like both teams have super deep rotation. So in the last one's like a perfect example of like the defense just giving Kenzie time. And like it's just one of her like strengths as a jammer is like persistence and just like skating super clean. So I thought I'd shout that out because she has like really, really fancy moves too. But the persistence is like a really like awesome skill as a jammer to not get frustrated when things aren't working. So it's a good thing to shout out, I think.
Yeah, I don't D.Va really recall jamming or skating all that much, right, D.Va? You know, you're only there a couple jams here and there, right?
Right.
So
I think that's what the timeouts are for, so that D.Va can stop skating.
Yeah. So those not fluent.
This game was so relaxing, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, completely. It was fun, for me, I don't know, I was like nervous going in. There was so much build up. Like someone was talking about earlier, is like we have played each other, we have a very similar skill set. It's just like, you know, it could be anybody's game, like absolutely.
Yeah,
and it was fun. I loved it. I don't know if I would describe it as chill, but it was a good time.
Yeah, Cheese is giving a shout out, bro. You're the cutest for holding up your hand. It's something new we're implementing, and it was Bro's suggestion, and I think it's working out great so far.
No one else is doing it, but it's okay.
You're gonna be the trendsetter.
It's true. Bro's always the trendsetter.
I want to ask Philly, Rousey ended up being a huge. Sorry, somebody have their. Yeah.
Got a feedback.
Feedback. Just hit me if you're not talking. And so, yeah, thank you so much. So Rousey ended up being like one to kind of watch for Philly. This is Rousey's rookie year, second year with Philly?
I think it's her third season, but she started as a blocker. And 2 years ago, or whenever we were in Dallas, sorry, I'm assuming this is where your question is going, but when we were in Dallas for playoffs, we were playing Victoria, and she has a figure skating background, so she's pretty good on her feet, like in her skates already. And so she got put into the jammer rotation versus Victoria, because she's very, very strong. And so after that game, she was like, I think that I'm better and I prefer jamming. And so the whole next season, she trained as a jammer. And so I think this year was her first, I don't know, first or second season as a jammer.
Okay, yeah, because I remember seeing her on the rosters, but I didn't remember her as so much as the jammer position. So Diva, did you encourage a little switcheroo here? Is that what happened?
No, actually, no. She's actually really strong. And this is probably, she probably jammed a lot more. She was one of our primary jammers. She's never ever looked tired. She's strong. It's hard at practice holding her.
I really love that insight. Oh, Pat, go ahead.
I was just going to say, this is the jam where she unfortunately, I think she actually went into our bench to avoid colliding with the referee. And, you know, because like Knotts and Paul had kind of set this up earlier, we kind of did the same thing, took the review and got the penalty for the save. It was just a weird setup with the benches, and jammers going into benches was a thing.
Yeah. So yeah, we mentioned that earlier in the program, you know, there was, you know, not a warning per se, just like a mention, hey, stay out of the bench area and things like that. And so Montreal, you use this official review to kind of throw it back to Philly a little bit, and win the official review. And I thought, you know, it was fun to watch, you know, the social media kind of blow that up and say, oh, okay, here we go. Yeah, so here's a replay coming in. Oh no, I'm in the wrong area. And Pat, you're like, excuse me, would you take a look at that? So that was really interesting to see that, you know, like, hey, we're gonna do this thing here too. Yeah, and then we have the head ref confirming this here. So it's very good. We're gonna go. You both have a chain. Your official views. Go ahead, Biggs.
It was just funny because, like I said, that's not like a common penalty that happens, and it just like. Within the same game, it happens twice. So
twice in the same period, yeah.
Yeah, in the same period. So wild. It's so wild.
All right. So still have our chat open. If you have any questions or, you know, comments about how either team is running their bench or strategy sessions, let us know. Falcon Punch right now is on a huge run. Or Montreal, and like we have such a close game here at this point too. Montreal, you start to catch up a little bit to Philly. And then we had the penalties kind of shown on the screen. So at this point, Montreal had then doubled the penalty count. So any comments on that?
Well, I was just going to say about this jam, having like Falcon doing what she does on a power jam is like, for us, like for me as a blocker, I'm like, okay, just stay out of her friggin' way, because she, like, Rousey hits super hard. Falcon is the hardest I've ever been hit, and we do it like twice or three times a week. So for us, this is like a good confidence jam to know like how powerful she is, and like what we need to do is like hold. So this is more like capitalizing on a moment for us, because we were super penalty heavy. So, you know, like building on a strength that we have, like we'll probably her do some damage. So it's just nice. Yeah, like I know you guys were saying, you all were saying getting hit by your own players is hard. Like,
Rousey, so hard.
yeah so it's nice to not be on the end of that for a game or tournament weekend, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, if we want to throw it back, rewind it just a little bit into the replay. Nah. I think after that hit from Falcon.
I love your face, Jill Diva,
who was that? Is that you, Diva? Like, were you asking for something at that point from the refs? Like, did you just see that? I don't know. Just roll back a little bit more to the replay. Here we go. Falcon punching through this defense and then ding, just like down. And he had the arms up like this, like, what?
Yeah, I was just going in the middle and just have, just asking the refs just watch out for like more. Like at the time, it just because how she just right there, if you could see, but I think Jill Bars was already going down to the ground because she hits hard. She comes in with power. You know,
yeah, it's one of those things where in the moment you're like, what, that must have been her forearm.
Yeah,
and then you like watch it and you're like, oh no, like that was a good hit. So true. I think watching back is like one of the good things to try and be like to remember in the game to not react to things like that, because you know, like officials are gonna see stuff, and you know, having a reaction isn't really like the best for staying in the game and present. So I know when I watch back, I try to take note and be like, hey, that wasn't smart. Like, let's get back up. So yeah, that's my little soapbox on that.
Yeah. Well, when you get hit hard,
weekly, yeah.
Yeah. It happens to the best of us. We do have a question from Yellow Fever. Montreal, did you purposely try to keep the pack in the apex? Because you do seem to have a nice sweet spot there in apex. I mean, I think every co will defensively say, watch the apex, watch the lines. But you seem to try to keep the pack in that general area. Was that part of your plan at all?
Well, I think in that circumstance, you can go. Yeah. Or I'll just continue, sorry. So in that instance, it was a power jam start. Yeah, so I think in our goal is just have somebody, hopefully more than one person, and then take them to a side, make it very obvious where we're going, so it allows our jammers to go wherever they need. Our jammers are very versatile. They're very good on those lines. You know, either one, it happened to be the apex that time. For us that we were blocking, our jammers are pretty good on those outside lines. So it wasn't necessarily a thought out conscious strategy that we're going to take them to the apex, but it was a strategy that we were going to take them to a side for sure.
Very cool. Bro, did you have a comment as well?
I think I was just going to say, typically we wouldn't want to set up there, but I think we were bridging back. And I think we wanted to have the tripod catch in the back, but no, it's not something we would like. Well, cause like Philly has good jumpers too. So I don't personally like to be there. And that's the other line that I just happened to be playing with probably because of a penalty. So I don't think they also would ever want to set up there. It was just kind of circumstance, right? To like get a good clamp down and not be pushed up by like Philly's like strong pushing jammers that like can squish us. Like, I think they said they wanted to do that at some point. We don't want to have that happen to us. Yeah.
Good call. At this point in the game, we do have a score switch here, lead change, and you know, Montreal now has the lead at this point. What were you feeling, Philly? I'll throw this to you, Bars. Did you have any sort of thing going on in go ahead.
Well, this was a rough couple of jams because I think this was a couple where they were able to keep Rousey in the penalty box. I think it's like three jams where, you know, and that's just good gameplay and planning where to get a couple penalties on Rousey and keep her in the box for multiple jams. But so I know that was a big like momentum shift as far as it's hard to score when your jammer's not on the track. So and especially like we're in the home stretch of the first half right now. So and we know from playing Montreal for not just this season previously, but for years, that you know they're gonna push it and make it really hard. You know, like coming out and scoring points first in the first couple minutes didn't mean anything. So anyway, I just feel like we knew it was going to be hard, and now like we're kind of like trying to get to halftime so we can get our rest and regroup, and so it was a rough couple of jams with some penalties.
And was that part of the strategy then, using you, Diva, to just get one rotation in as a jammer?
I think it's just to relieve our other jammers that we have. Mm-hmm. And then I had to go back and blocking. And Biggie's, I just have to say, every time going against her, she just smiles. When you come and make contact with her, she's just smiling, waiting for her. She wants to make contact with you. And I'm like trying to avoid her, but she just smiles the whole time.
That's just my nervous face, I swear. I'm like, ah!
Yeah, you Canadians gotta be so friendly all the time. Said me before I went out there.
Pat, were you about to say something?
No, I was just running with the joke.
Okay, cool. Reptar, we do have a question for you. What was the Derby origin story behind your name? Was it from Rugrats?
No. Well, I mean, it is from Rugrats, but I didn't actually pick the name myself. I started in a league where everybody was brand new, and the day that everybody had to have their name. And, 2 weeks before we were supposed to have it, we were talking about it. I was talking about with another skater, and they're like, oh, I think I'm going to be Reptar. And I was like, oh, I haven't thought of a name yet. And then the day came, and they're going down the line and just writing down names of the clipboard. And I was right before the girl I had talked to before. And I looked at her and I said, so are you still going to be Reptar? No, I changed my mind. And I was like, oh, I still haven't thought of a name. And then I turned my head and they were at me at that point, and I just said Reptar.
Love it.
Sorry.
I don't have an affinity for Rugrats.
Yellow Fever says, I love it. Thank you for letting us know. And then Sociopath, thank you for joining us on the Twitch feed. Just so happy that this is like reflective of Derby. Definitely what we're all feeling, that everybody's enjoying us, you know, this program and you all being here. Getting a little bit Derby fever back in our hearts. And Magnum PEI says, cutest name origin story ever. And that's great. And thank you from Derby Falcony for subscribing. Derby from the Balcony wants to know, was there someone you enjoyed challenging you on the track from the opposing team? I would like to throw that first to Biggs.
Yeah, Diva, 100%. Because I played you with God when I was new to the skids. And I remember just getting like winded so many times. Actually, even in our playoff game, I tried to do offense on you and I just like winded myself off of your body. It's just like, you're such a challenging player. I was so stoked to actually try to block you. Try is the biggest word there. like when you got to jam, because I haven't seen you jam in a while, so that was really exciting for me. I love playing you. It was definitely a huge honor. So, and I'm glad that we were able to pull you out of jammer retirement for this game.
Smart, wicked smart. And actually, at this point in the game, just as we're, you know, keeping tabs, both of your benches through an official review, and both of you got, you didn't retain it, but you gave your benches 2 minutes of relief, which was fantastic because the score gets super picky and prickly right now. So that was very smart on both of your benches. And now it just gets all out war as we go into the half. I will throw it to you, bro. And just, you know, was there someone on the track against Philly that you just enjoyed playing against?
Well, a fun fact about Philly, I had never finished a game against Philly because for some reason, like, they just have my number in terms of like the sheer physicality. So I was like, I'm finishing this game. Like, I'm not very intimidating. I'm not big. I'm not a big hitter. So I think playing teams like Philly that are like, I just find super powerful and like play like a physical game. Like I like playing defense. Like it's not this style for me. So a lot of it was mental. The other person was Persephone, because in our playoff game, she had like 100% lead against our line. And we didn't even realize it. We were like, what is going on? Like it was someone taking stats that was like, you have to deal with Persephone. She's just eating you alive. Or I don't know their pronouns, but sorry. So I think we focused a lot on this game, like getting ready for that, because sometimes like a certain jammer has your line's number. So that was like a challenge for us to say, we have to shut this down, because we looked at the stats and from the start we were more prepared. So that was the like skater. I remember just so friendly on the line, and we were trying to be so intense. And I'd say that's who I focused on in like preparation for the game. Also,
and just throwing that out there, did any of you have any intimidation factor going into this like huge group of official reviewer type, you know, you had all these officials cheering on the officials and it was really loud in the venue, so did that, you know, play into anybody's like, you know, mental game at all, Biggs?
I loved it so much. I think we should definitely do it more often. Honestly, officials don't get enough credit. Like, we can't play the sport without them. Like, fuck, blah, blah, blah. Just cheer for them. They make it happen. You know, like, it's good.
Yeah, I thought that moment was great. Like, just being on the bench and then like realizing what the whole like spectator official section was doing. It was just like, I don't know. It made me smile because it was like so cute. And yeah, like no one ever cheers for them, but they're super important and great. So it was, yeah, I thought it was not intimidating. I thought it was awesome.
I thought it was JB, great. The only people that were going to get grumpy about it were other refs.
That's right. Yeah. The refs, it was kind of cute to see their faces like, oh my gosh, we're, you know, the spotlight is a little bit on us. And they were like trying to get back to be focused, get the game rolling. But that was really, I'm glad that y'all enjoyed it, because I thought that was a fantastic area to like have in the venue. JB, I was going to throw the question to you. Was there anybody on the track that you particularly liked going up against on Montreal?
Well, this jam is probably the perfect one, because I remember like Falcon Punch being really hard in the off game, and like in this one, like I said earlier, like felt like someone had their number. Like I, again, like watching tape, like you can see like, okay, well, you weren't really prepared for that contact at all. Like you weren't low enough. And you know, super strong and super skilled. So playing against Falcon was pretty fun. And I remember like from playoffs thinking that she was pretty talented. So yeah.
And then Reptar, I'll talk to you since you're jamming at this point.
Oh, the person who was a challenge?
Yeah.
Questions, everybody else? Oh, okay. Well, I think I already called it out earlier, Biggs. You're just like that one that's always sneaky whenever you think you're almost out. If like you like rest for a second getting out, you're like, I feel like I found myself in a moment with you several times.
Diva, did you have anybody?
Jamming, I would say all my blockers, because I don't like being stopped. Because I just, being a blocker, I would have to say they were all different. And I think it's that we had to try to, for myself, to adapt, because they got us moving. Our walls moving. And we just had to like slow it down and try to keep contact with them, because they were like dancing all the time.
Yeah, at this point, you know, we've reached the half, and it's, you know, we see that this only 1 point off Philly. You're maintaining that lead by 1 point prior to the half. Biggs, what's up?
I do want to mention, because I actually bugged the refs right now, because it's 63-64, but you'll notice when we come back at 64, we had a point behind us. So I went up to the ref, I was like, you missed a point. We have a point behind us, and this is what tied the game coming into the second half. So I'm just like, I was so happy to get that like tied game. It just made that game even so much better. Just like going in tied.
What a game. Oh my goodness. Yeah, because once we come back from the half, you'll see that the score is tied. So I'm going to throw it to first you, Montreal. What was your thoughts going into the locker room? What were the things that you wanted to discuss? You go first, Biggs.
Okay. For us, we started to pick up momentum. Obviously, we're feeling good about that. We really didn't want to lose that momentum. So again, we always talk about controlling the speed of the game. That's our biggest focus a lot of the times, is slowing down the game, taking control of that, getting leads. Those are what we need to work on. So usually we have a little breather before we go into our halftime talk, and then we come together and give a few focuses. But that was mostly it, I think. Anyone?
Pat?
Keeping the good momentum from the later part of that period, and also bearing in mind that the score being pretty much a wash, it's kind of we're starting a whole new game in period two. I think something that got said a lot between the teams in the pregame meeting is everyone knew how hungry everyone's going to be to win this game. It's both teams having their last game of the season, the last game of champs. So knowing that they're going to come out at 100%, and we have to maintain and match the same intensity.
Great. And then, bro?
Yeah, I think it was now you can look back and it was great, because it was exactly the challenge we wanted, a team that prepared for us so well, but also I was saying before, we're our biggest obstacles sometimes. So if we were getting caught in what we're doing wrong, or here we go again, we're going to have a bad last game of champs. I think it just shows the work we put in mentally to be I was really proud that we could hold, we never crumbled, whenever things were maybe not going our way. So for us, it was that added challenge of okay, we just got to chill. We know we can do this if we stick to all the building blocks we put into place, what we've done differently this season. So I think you try not to think about all that and try to just trust the process. It's tricky because, Philly's doing the same thing. They've worked just as hard, and they have this awesome meteoric rise that you have to respect. But I think we were just this is really important to us. So let's trust that we can do this. Trust that we're missing one of our serious, one of our high rotation blockers. So looking at people in the crowd to use all of that to be okay, anyways, it's not a great answer, but I think we just knew we worked really hard to finish the way we wanted to finish. So that was kind of one of the things, we just have to let it happen. Don't analyze too much, just do what we prepared to do. So.
Well, thank you for that. Yeah. And then I'll throw it now to Philly. We'll start with you, Reptar.
I think going into the half, it was just, Patricide was saying, it's a wash. It's this is a whole nother game just starting out. We just have to keep the penalties down and come out with the same strength that we had in the beginning, play off of what we learned from the first half of what was working and what wasn't working, and just try to play our game mostly.
Awesome. Thank you for that. Diva?
Yeah, I would just say, just piggyback off of Reptar, it's we just got another chance to go into what we did in the first half to focus on going into the second half. But this was Philly's first time going to chance since we had our dresses. So that's and at the same time, we never really got past the first round at chance. So this was regardless, going to this, we're still in this game, and it was a fight. But also it felt like it was a lot of fun at the same time.
Awesome. Thank you, Dia. And then Jails?
Yeah. I think we always have, our coaches will talk and packs will kind of talk. And we always pick a couple of things that we know we need to improve on. So, normally penalties is on that list. And then for this game, I would say cover our line coverage. We realized, that's something we have to clean up from a blocking perspective. So, we kind of tried to pick a couple of things because you can't do everything. So we try to pick the things that we are noticing, talk about, and acknowledge what we have to change. Yeah. I mean, same as what Diva was saying. It's like the last game of the year. It was at Champs. It was, you know, like not like just for fun, but we had already lost. You know, we weren't in the Hydra race anymore. So it was just really exciting.
Well, thank you for that insight as you go into the locker room. Yeah, so many feels as we start to head into the halftime. So what we're going to go ahead and do is take a break here, about 5 minutes, and reset and, you know, come back to this game. It's going to be 0-0, basically, as we come into Philly versus Montreal from Game 11, the 2019 WFTDA International Championships in Montreal. So stay tuned. Welcome back to Upon Review, live show. Here on Twitch for WTDA. I'm Chloe from Cupcake, hosting Game 11 of the matchup of Montreal and Philly from the 2019 International WFTDA Championships in Montreal, Canada. For Philly, we have Jailbars, V-Diva, and Reptar commenting on their reaction, alongside with Biggley, Patricide, and Labrosse from Montreal. And going into the half, we have an even score here. So we'll go ahead and pull up the just the games so we can see that the score there. And it's a 64 apiece. We have quite a few questions coming in and fielding in from our chat room. Going into the second half of the game, Montreal, what was your plan coming in against Philly? What were you going to do differently, or were you going to do anything differently? Were you going to still play your game how it was? Was there any adjustment on your part? I'll throw it to starting with you, Biggley.
Like I was saying before, we were trying to just like slow down the game. It was a fresh start, like, so 64-64, it's zero pretty much going into the second half. So our biggest thing was like controlling the jammers, controlling that they're not going to be getting leads. So that means lots of contact, lots of focus on locking them down. Because sometimes when we struggle, it's usually when we get into like a one-off, like all of us are like individually working. So our focus was communicating on being together. Yeah.
Pat?
Yeah, I think everything that Bigley just said, and I don't know how much we talked about it. I think amongst, like, in terms of like lineup matchings and such, we discussed the fact that I know we saw Diva jam a few times in the first half, but as she said, for like extra relief and such, it was a change from playoffs, so we had to kind of figure out a bit of our matchups.
And we'll go ahead and do it in a second here, bro. But Reptar, you come off that line in the first half, like, immediately. Was that a, like, did you have new starts? Did Philly have some sort of plan in place specifically for starts? Oh, no. We lost your audio.
Oh, no. Sorry. I had it muted. Everyone in the happy to know that I'm the one with the dog barking next door. So I'm just going to keep it muted unless I'm talking. But as I was saying, there was like, just like, we kind of like work really well with our walls and the jammers. And I think we had just like wanted to work on a different start on that one. I luckily have a really good relationship with my offensive player. Shout out to Tramagachi. So that wasn't all me.
Nice, very good. Okay, I will throw it back to you, bro. You know, going into the second half, what was your feeling going into it? Was there any strategy there? Right now, we just saw Miracle Whips with the lead jam position, but already picking up a jammer penalty. So I'll go ahead and throw it to you now.
Yeah, I think what kind of like similar to what Philly said, tweaking stuff. So we're lucky to have like skaters who are watching and giving us like really targeted feedback. And I remember one of our line mates, Elda, had said like this, this, and this. So I think like you're just focusing, like you're focusing on like a lot of little things to fix and just trying not to worry too much about like the momentum swings and like, yeah, keep it calm. So And like Pat, well, everyone was saying it's like a new game, which is awesome. It's great to be like, okay, let's just push everything behind and like tweak the things we know we can tweak. And it's very exciting. Obviously, it's like playing in front of a home crowd like this is just so, so awesome. So I'm trying not to get too like hyped up from that also, because like we was saying too, we play better calm and like focused. So we're trying not to like be too much like in how cool it is, but more like, okay, what do we want to do and how do we like stick with it?
So. Well, thank you for that. Yeah, I know it's pretty tough. You know, this is Montreal, USA that we're dealing with here. It was a great throwback there from Saucius for that mention. Yeah, so then, you know, I'll throw it then to Dale's, you know, what was the, you know, consensus going into the second half here for Philly? I mean, you had a strong opening here. You know, what was your thought process going into the second half for you specifically?
Yeah, I think the main thing was to try to, you know, keep our penalties down. We're the strongest when we have four blockers on the track and our jammer. So I think that was and normally is always like the main focus. And, you know, that helps with just keeping the game under control as well. But then also, like, I know, like, their jammers were really good at taking the lines. So, like, that was, I just remember that from this game being, like, something that we were, like, that we have to make sure to close on.
And Diva, your group up in the front wall for Philly, what were you discussing during this official timeout?
It was basically plugging and trying to get on to them to try to play all, to give Steph Leopard opportunity. If you notice, like when Trauma and Reptar, we were trying to do a scenario that happened there, but Montreal moved back on us too fast, it looks like in the video, and we were not able to do that. But yeah, so we were just trying to do what was very successful in last GM.
Very good. And then Reptar, was there anything, you know, from the locker room that you were going to bring into the second half for your performance? You're on mute.
You're muted.
Sorry.
She's messing up people's drinking game.
I know. If it's not a drinking game, it's a bingo.
I know. I messed up the dog game for everyone. I'll just leave it on. Yeah, I think it was just remembering that everyone on this team is – I'm going to put my foot in my mouth if I go out here and take lines a million times again, but I was trying to tell myself to remember these people are good at hitting people out and trying to be more careful about taking those lines, but we'll see if I actually listen to myself. I haven't watched this one back in a while.
Yeah, everybody's talking about how well Philly, your drawback is for your defense, and then Montreal for your poise about this entire game. So, you know, everybody's pretty stoked and excited for this particular game. We do have a couple of questions to field you. Specifically, we're going to throw it to you, Diva. You know, Bones would like to know, how did it feel returning back to Philly for both you and your teammates? And then coming to this big Philly, stage.
Philly is like has my heart. I mean, I love the opportunity that I had playing with Gotham. It just, I think it's the commute. I live about 3 hours away, one direction. But everyone at Philly is, and they are hard workers, and they're fun to be around. I was just really honored to have them welcome me back, and you know, able to work aside them again. And we just set goals. And last time, like, we went to champs was in, what, 2014 and 2015, maybe? But it just, this was this season, this last season was, like, everyone wanted this. I mean, their goal was always to get the Hydra. But we really worked worked extra hard this past season with not just, I can't just say with us transfers coming in, because the foundation of Philly was already there. It's just that like Reptar coming in, myself coming, and Frankenstein coming back in, and then skaters that have been around. We just really worked on new strategy and also take from the old strategy to apply it, what worked, what didn't work, to try to improve. And we took each game by game and really set our focus. And I feel like, you know, I think we surprised ourselves how fast we moved up in the rankings. But we worked really hard. I'm very proud of everyone.
Thank you for giving us insight into that. And, you know, I wanted to bring it back a little bit to the game as well. Right now, Montreal, you're doing this crazy weird thing where you're just like flowing up lanes 2 and 3, really blowing up Philly defensive wall. Like, you have kind of like a follow the leader, like right for this instance in turn number 3, someone goes up, blows it up a little bit, then someone follows through. Was this part of your strategy going into the second half, Biggs?
Yeah, Cheese is also especially really good at this. She just lights up formation so good, and like very active. I know that's something that I've done this season as well, is doing a little bit more active offense, because it's easy to just be like, y'all good? You good up there? Passive. You know, we were trying to actually like go do things, get it done. And like Cheese is a perfect example of that. It's like, you'll see it in this gym, you'll see it in multiple ones. So good. My baby.
Cheese is going to be very stoked in the chat room for that. You know, Reptar, you had such a quick, like such quick movement off the jam line. We talked about that a little bit earlier. And I'm just wondering, like, if, you know, when you do these sort of things and you come off really quickly, was that kind of like some advice that you were going to give to Rousey? Because I know that Rousey had a little bit of penalty bowl as we went into the half. You know, what was your jammer? I guess what I'm asking is, what was your jammer like situation as far as like pumping each other up and each other get back into play?
I mean, like with all jammers, or just like with Rousey in particular?
With Rousey in particular. Rousey was kind of in a, you know, downward spiral with penalties. What was in your jammer huddle? How did you get her back on track?
Just kind of checking in with one another, like the same way that our packs talk with one another. We like to meet with the jammers and we all kind of like talk out what we're going through. And a lot of like me and Rousey have obviously very different styles. So like coming from a different perspective kind of helps remind her, you know, like you have the strength, but like just like kind of hone in, be a little more patient. And, you know, whenever those penalties are happening, you to get, you know, in those moments, and just like coming back to center is the most important part, and it's really good to have other jammer friends to kind of bring you back to that center.
That's a really good point. Thank you for that insight. You know, if we can actually go back to this replay, it looks like Montreal had a reaction to that wonderful you know, entry of one of their own, little friendly fire here. You'll see in the replay at the end there, right in turn number 3. Well, Miracle Whips is having a little reaction to it. But here we go. We're going to have, as they come into this turn, Montreal, why don't you take over and let us know how you're feeling right about now.
Yeah, bro and I, like we work so well together. I love it. But I can't speak for bro, but in the second half, I felt like, so much energy built, like, I'm going to chase them down. I am a chaser, but like, some, usually it's bad. But this felt very strong. And then we were just like, just all of us were on the same page that we kind of worked together to capture the jammer. And, you know, I get a little extra with my flaily body. It was a good capture. We were able to lock down and able to get those points together. So that was cool.
I was just laughing because of how well Biggley was doing, but how like intense she looked. Like, I don't think I've ever seen Biggley like run someone back like that. And it's cute. Like, I'm not making fun of her. She like did so well. But it just was like, I think we all gulped because her face, you like, zoomed in on her face, like, so hungry. But it was so good. We can make
I just look like, so interested. Get it done.
Yeah, she's loving that hustle by Mange. So yeah, good call there. And then Sociopath is loving that drawback slide. It's just fantastic. Everybody's enjoying that that work there from Montreal. All right, now we are about 21 minutes remaining in the second half of Philly and Montreal. There was a change. Montreal, now you are top, 82-78. Skirtu Bichu is jamming. At this point, Philly, you started to run into a little bit of penalty trouble, not too much, but you were at least down one skater, so you had to recalibrate. What was that like as far as the blockers? You know, maybe not so much from a mental standpoint, but like a strategy standpoint, did you have something in place for when you were doing 3-on-4? I'll throw that to you, Jails.
Yeah, I mean, we like to practice throughout the season, you know, working on our 3-wall, and we'll work on like throwing either like someone from the opposing, the other pack. So we have 2 primary packs. So we'll work on like rotating in people who we don't normally skate with. So we get reps with that too. And even we'll do drills where, you know, someone in mid jam randomly gets pulled out. And just pretty much we do that to try so that when it happens in games, we're not like scrambling and like, oh crap, oh crap. So I think, you know, like there's no set, like when this happens, we do this. We just try to drill it so that when it does happen, it's not as much of like a cluster.
That makes sense. Very cool. Well, it seems that even though you were sitting down one, you prepared for that in some way, because it wasn't like you notice some teams, they become a little frantic for your defense. I thought you did very well there. And so that really shows. So thank you for the insight on how you prepare for that. So now we have Falcon Punch throwing a little bit of jammer versus jammer positioning. And I wonder, was this for box penalty box relief? I think there was one in the box here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it helps us get low rider back or cheese on the track. Yeah.
Smart. Very good choice. And so, yeah, so everybody was like, what's happening? And then almost immediately everybody turns and looks who's in their box. Because I think it seems like at this level, both squads are doing things for specific reasons. So that was a really smart choice. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to, I think Steph Leopard didn't play. I don't think we played much against that jammer at playoffs. And I know this, like, there was a couple jams where they're just on fire, including this one. So it kind of backfired, but that was our, that's what we tried to do.
Yeah, I was going to say, maybe Reptar, you can give us a little more insight. You know, what was this more like a relief jammer position for Steph Leopard, or was this more like we wanted to throw a wrench in Montreal's game plan?
I think inevitably Steph just ends up being both of those things. I mean, she is one of our relief jammers, but when she goes out there, like you just saw in that replay, she'll just pull out these crazy moves that you're just like, what did you just do?
And yeah, awesome. She's someone who works like so hard and like always gives it just like so much effort and in like practice, and then when she gets these moments in these games, you know, like she just goes off. And, yeah, she had a great game at champs.
Yeah, very effective, I would say. And we actually, you know, have a another question from our chat room. Roller Derby Life is asking, Montreal, was there a blocker missing from your roster in this game? I'll throw it to Jeff. Biggs, your cat.
Oh, Jake.
Oh, Jake.
Jake. Oh, God. I called him Jeff. Jeff? Jeff Jake from State Farm. Saving. Jake.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, Big. It was Wild Sirius was missing from the pack. He was out with an ankle injury. It was definitely, you know, we were devastated to not have her. And I know it was hard for her It's hard for anybody with injuries, for sure. So we felt her missing on track was definitely a big presence. So it's hard. I love playing with you, Sirius. Not that I play, but you know. Was that a good answer from Jake or Jeff, whatever you want to call
him? Jake Jeffery, great job.
Chatty.
Happy Catterday, everybody.
Oh my God.
Wow. PEI says Jeff. So thank you for throwing me in the loop there. Thank you, Ashley, for subscribing to Twitch Prime, for being on WFTDA's channel here. So yeah, you know, if anybody has more questions to field to either Montreal or Philly, they are ready for your questions. We have a huge change here now for Montreal, 105-84. Momentum is definitely shifting here, and there was a huge jam there for Miracle Whips. And also, like, your defensive line, you really, like, throw heavy hits to Philly. Here we show the replay. Strong two-wit for Philly. And you just exhaust Miracle Whips. D.Va, at this point, you're going to come in and you're going to start jamming a little bit more often for Philly. So how was this momentum was getting to your bench? Was your bench saying anything specific? Were you changing anything up at this point in the game?
I don't think we were really changing a lot up. I think it was just more of trying to lock down the jammer. We were doing more of going in for the hits, bunnies for it, or like we're bridging. So we end up playing a lot of the times down blockers. So we were not able to help our jammers as much. And also, like, Miracle Whip had a wonderful game. Like, it was a different game than it was at playoffs. And like, I feel like the game got a little bit more intense, especially when the score switched. We definitely saw Montreal coming out a little bit more aggressive with smiles on their face. And we were not ready for that at the start. I mean, I wasn't. But we just had to get down under their jammers and start treating them like what we do to our jammers, you know, like you win or we win. So it's like, but it definitely came to, when there's 30 minutes of like the second half, I always tell the team is like, we go by 15 minutes. After the 15 minutes, we have a second 15 minutes of the 30. Like, you really have 4 periods to make adjustments. So
yeah, and that's a good point. I mean, we're now in the fourth period at this point, about 20, you know, points separating your two teams,
right?
And people are like, you know, I'm sure at this point, I remember the energy in the arena. It was getting, you know, we're on day 3 of champs, and so all we are going to see now at this point is just good derby. There's like no choice. Like everything's going to be at an intensity level of 1,000. So, you know, that was a really good point to break it down into periods, but also say, you know, every 15 minutes, we just got to go hard here. And so you're seeing that on both sides. Both teams are like coming off the track, like kind of, you know, holding their thighs and just trying to like catch their breath here. So that was kudos.
Yeah,
to
I don't
both,
know if anyone got spots. Lead in that one or anyone, no one scored, but like those jams that go like 2 minutes and no one gets out and you're just constantly like pushing and recycling and like they are so tough to then like come off and there's just no points on the board. So yeah, I like could see I was gasping for air at the end of that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kyle Kenzie was coming off.
I just want to shout out to...
Yo, go ahead.
I just wanted to shout out to Whips. I just wanted to shout out to Whips though, because she did play this game like after coming back from an injury. You notice her they're actually wrapped up. She has like a hip flexor thing going on. So, you know, Philly did a great job of like hurting all our thighs. So because, like, she came back with flying colors. She had an excellent game. Like,
yeah.
Asked for more from her. So, great job.
Yeah, that was a really good point. All the wrappings and stuff, like we had Mama and Papa Doc, you know, trackside. So just like everybody was getting wrapped at this point. So the crowd was just like in it. And Montreal, you actually threw a timeout Stopping the clock at 13 minutes. Was there any sort of folks for this particular timeout as you went into it? I'll throw it to you, bro.
I don't remember why. Maybe, I don't know. I'll have to throw it to you, Pat, because I don't remember why we called a timeout. Maybe just rest. Maybe just because we have two blockers. I'm just making stuff up, so I don't know. Sorry, I don't remember.
It was partly rest and partly the energy. Like, we don't have the sound on the video, but if I remember, it was getting incredibly loud in the venue at this point, which I wasn't a treat for either, but it was, you know, a hindrance for both teams, I think, because it makes it hard for players to hear the bench, and there's this energy that comes from that just affects everyone on the track. So it was kind of like a, you know, trying to remind everybody that we've got control here. Just take a minute to catch our breath and settle down. Let all of our poor taped up jammers get an extra moment of rest and really just reset mentally to finish strong for the rest of the game.
Yeah. I'm going to jump in on that as well, too.
Go ahead.
Something we also, sorry, we also consider the game in like four parts because we previously we wouldn't always finish the games as we wanted. So it was always be like, okay, we need to take that 10-minute reset and realize that we have 10 minutes to go in this game. It is that is the game that we're focusing on. So if this was at 13 minutes or so, somewhere around that time, we normally will try to take like a break at a time just to refocus our attention. It's like, we're still in this. It doesn't matter what happened right now, we're still in it. Kind of that.
Yeah, good. I mean, we were just seeing a little bit of the moment there for Reptar. You were coming through there, and it looked like Red Rover game gone completely wrong. You just had to like bust through Montreal's defense there. But the intensity was just leveled up. You had this, you know, we even have people that were there in the arena mentioning in the chat room. It was so good. And then we also have this pressure. We pull up penalties here now, and I believe it's like 28 penalties. 28 penalties to 18. Montreal, you're really getting close there. And so, like, the intensity level was turned up to an 11. You know, Montreal, how are you feeling about, you know, now seeing your penalties on the board at this point? Was penalties a factor in how you're going to play your game going into the rest of the game?
I can start it. We do struggle with penalties. I specifically struggle with penalties. I know that I'm always a heavy penalty, but our team does usually get quite a few. I'm sure Philly probably knew that and could capitalize on that. So it's not something we weren't used to, but we have it in our heads to focus on, like, let's try not doing that.
Pat?
No, to Biggley's point, it is something we tried to focus on for the season, and you know, I tried to bring some of my own experience with penalties to help the team refocus. But it's a hard thing to control in any game. I'm sure any player will tell you, like, you can't control how the game is going to be called. You can just respond to how it is being called in that moment. But I was going to say is right here in this game is an example of where I think the energy and the noise got to everybody. Both teams are about to get a penalty because we didn't have a jammer on the track, and Philly's coach was in the middle of the track when the whistle went. So, like, both teams get a delay of game, and I think it was just a total miscom on both sides because it was just so loud and so crazy with the energy that was got from the crowd in this game that, like, this kind of stuff doesn't normally happen to champ-level teams. But yet, here we are, both getting needless bench penalties on both sides, so.
Yeah, we had a cruise too in the center, so it was hard for not only to hear anything, but then we had like a couple mic issues going around in the venue. So yeah, it kind of throws a little bit of a wrench into any sort of plans here. At this point, it's like, it's, I don't want to say an announcer curse or if it's bingo, you know, it's anybody's game, but you know, with a 28 point differential, it's like, it really could go either way. And I think, bro, did you have something to add to that? I mean, with timeout?
this is horrible. I'm the only person on the track and I'm in the queue to go to the box. So it's like pretty much a nightmare. It's my nightmare. It'd be worse if I had a star. But I think we just had to be like, whatever. I got the captain penalty. So I think we, like, looking at those penalties, we had to, like, acknowledge it, but also not start to, like, lay any blame or start to be like, hey, you clean it up. Like, not that any team should do that. But I think we had to just brush it off, like, especially right now. Like, yeah, Diva's out there against, like, one of our players. It's a nightmare. So I think it speaks to how we didn't focus on that. Like, you can see, like, Trizy and Lower still smiling. I think we know when we're, like, relaxed but taking it seriously, that's how we do our best. So I think you can see, like, we're doing a good job of sticking with that plan and not getting uptight and not, like, not perseverating on how shitty it could be. So, yeah.
Yeah. Great considering. So good on you. And then, Diva, you were just in that last jam, like, you know, a force there. What were you saying when you were coming off the track there? You kind of had a lot of words to give your team.
I'm probably saying I can go again. Jam to keep them in the box. Plus the Paul Williams and Knotts had me to call it and probably, and then they told me to go back out. So at that time, but I remember during this game, I was like talking to my pack as a jammer to asking them like what I need or whatever. I couldn't even hear myself talk. Like, it was so loud in there.
Yeah. I mean, at this, you know, and then plus you have skaters pulling apex jumps out of nowhere, you know, erupts and all that noise too. So it was just like, you, both of your squads were just pulling off amazing triumphs on the track. And I think at this point we have almost a full pack here. So, you know, y'all had to recalibrate and go into this now, and the score gap is closing. So, Philly, you're catching right back up here at this point. We do have a question for you, Pat, actually. Let me go ahead and pull it up. Recordian asks, why would you give to officials who are looking to start coaching? Well, that's a heavy-handed one, but that's a really good question.
Hi, Recordian. Looking to start coaching, I think there's this strange expectation that officials are going to be good at coaching, and I think that's like a false assumption. Maybe it has to do with knowing the game. I think advice I would have would be to, you know, like, be confident in what you know about the sport of roller derby and your expertise, but also being humble because you're new to the role of coaching. And just be there to kind of observe and listen, which is something that referees, good referees, know how to do.
Thank you for that. Yeah, if we can get another replay switch here, because I think we have this official review coming in, which I thought was an interesting take for Philly. Philly, you asked this official review, but it almost looks as though I think it was going to be called on your jammer here. Like, yeah, we see a nice apex hop, but you come in and possibly a low block. So what was the call for the official review about? Anybody
remember at that time?
Yeah.
No, I don't remember.
Too many times
Go ahead, Pat.
Because I had to be in the interviews. This was Philly was challenging that she, the jammer, sorry, I didn't see which jammer was, landed inbounds before falling. And ultimately, you'll see the replay. Takes off, passes Biggley, lands like 1 foot in before falling down, which, per the rules, is, you know, how you get them points. So The Philly review was about the 0 points that was given on that apex jump. And then it will be followed by a Montreal review, which, like, I know everyone just loves all the constant official reviews and timeouts of this game. I'm sorry, like, Derby World, who was watching this game. I got so many comments from people complaining about that.
Well, I think that's a really odd thing that, you know, I can understand people want to keep the game going. And I know people will complain about that. And they're there'll be somebody in the crowd being like, boring, we get it. But for all the games that I've seen, this is the first game I've ever seen a back-to-back official review in the first half, both won, and then a back-to-back official review, kind of just giving both teams a break of 2 minutes. And now we're going to have another back-to-back official review again. So yeah, there were official reviews and a lot of official time taken. But I think from a strategic standpoint, I think it was well played out. I mean, how do you feel about that? I mean, I'll throw it to you first, Pat, since you know a little bit more about how that played out.
Sorry, was that to me?
Yeah, sorry.
I mean, I think it was challenging. Like, for me personally, I think a lot of my role on the bench involves managing the time and these communications and such. And so it was kind of fun both times we had games with Phillies this time to be kind of challenging each other from the bench in that way. And obviously in this case, part of the idea with winning the review was if we won, that would then lose the points because I was trying to get a penalty on the airborne contact, which we did not win. But yeah, I think it's a balance. Like, you don't want to affect the flow of the game, to your point from before, and it's not fun for anybody if we're having to stop constantly, and it's hard for the athletes, obviously, when we have this whole start and stop pace to the game. But I also think that part of the role of the coaches with the reviews and the timeouts is to really manipulate the clock to the best of our advantage to give those players the most opportunity they can to win a game.
Yeah, good call. I mean, not only that, I mean, we're seeing the reaction of the crowd here too. They're, you know, they're all invested in this. It's only a 10-point game at this point. And, you know, like we said, you know, there was a little bit of penalty trouble on Montreal bench, but, you know, you were able to rebound pretty, you know, pretty well and keep a steady pace throughout the rest of the game. And so now we're just going back and forth. Philly, you had just retained your review, and Montreal is challenging that contact. So we're seeing a little bit more about what the crowd was like here, again, with the official review cheer squad. So everything was amplified times a million. And Phila Ming Ding Dong, totally reading that wrong, says, I think Philly has to be careful with only one timeout left with 9 minutes remaining. So, you know, Pat, you were talking about the clock and managing it pretty well here. And, you know, Charles, what was it like on your bench as far as management goes, as far as, you know, you only have one timeout left, and you've just retained your review, so you really only have two timeouts remaining.
I was just thinking, like, good thing we won that official review, because we're going into the final 9 minutes and we don't have a lot of stoppages left. So, you know, that's one of the things where when you do have these, like, hectic moments earlier in the game and you use the timeouts to collect yourself, that come to hurt and bite you in the butt when you get down to these really close games with only a couple minutes left and you have one stoppage. So, you know, it comes down to being smart with that mid-game and, you know, like, not having to use too many stoppages too early on. So I think it's great because Nazi's very smart and has a lot of officiating experience. So a lot of our reviews were used wisely, I guess, this season. And, you know, we get the benefit of retaining that review. So we weren't lucky, you know, it was a good call on his part. But yeah, it's just something you need to be smart with, and it paid off.
Yeah, rightfully so. And now at this point in the game, we're seeing a lot of movement on the track. I think at this point, both squads were, you know, a little bit mostly discombobulated, because that implies that, like, it wasn't thought out, because you were both doing, you know, thought out processes, but it just seems like it was a little more hectic on both sides. You know, the walls weren't forming as quickly as they were before. Everything is more physical. So, of course, you know, we're cutting into the last few moments of the half. Defensively, Philly, you were very strong. What was, you know, you were kind of flowing throughout the game a little bit more loosely towards the end. What was that? What was the talk like on your bench, strategy wise or emotionally? Like, what was your plan trying to finish up this game strong? I'll throw it to you again, Jails.
Yeah, like final 10 minutes of a close game are just always, I feel like they get more chaotic. And but I feel it on our bench, we do have a pretty good system of, you know, a jam ends, we come to the bench and we try to sit down and start the next jam and prepare. And, you know, we have our pre-jam meeting. And so we talk about how we're going to line up and like what we're going to look for. And so I think like keeping to that system is really beneficial in the crazy games, because you don't really get too caught up on like the craziness. You're kind of already starting to focus on what's next and what do we have to do next to make us successful. You know, so we just try to have a plan, you know, send our offense as soon as we can, have our jammers looking for it. So things like that is what we try to do.
I'll give Diva a chance to also reply to that question. But first, Biggs, I got to know what's going on in your mind now, because I'm seeing a little bit of a reaction to you watching the game. How are you feeling at this point watching this game over? Oh, are you on mute?
Yeah, sorry about that. I was on mute. So again, there were a little bit of penalty trouble. So the previous jam, we're starting with two. And yeah, you know, it's never a fun time starting low. So it's more or less like we did what we could. And right now, every second counts. So if we can touch the jammer, that's all that matters. I barely did and just kind of melted into the ground a little bit, but it's okay.
Diva, how are you feeling at this point in the game?
I would say it was a intense, because there's only 5 minutes left. And mm-hmm. just re-talking to our packs on things that worked, what didn't work, and what did our jammers need to try to close out and have a win. But with regardless of any of the things, I mean, both teams wanted to win. But this is the first time that Philly made it this far in a long time. And also being able to play at this, you know, at this level at champs in a very long time, and being able to play against Montreal, I feel like we played them so many times. So, and it was very grateful. You know, they're a really nice team to play against.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. Regardless of the score, it was a wonderful matchup. So, and you know, you have that history between your two leagues. So, everybody was saying the same thing. I remember, you know, in the crowd and you know the announcers, we were saying, you know, they are giving us a show right now. So, you're both fantastic to watch. Reptar, I want to throw it to you because you just had a conversation with the refs in the infield there. What was going on with the conversation there? And then also, were you feeling a lot of pressure at this point? Because you have like maybe 10 minutes or 10 points between you two and it's 4 minutes left. Two-part question. I'll throw it to you now.
No pressure at all. No. Last game, 10 minutes. 10 points. No. Yeah. I feel pressure. I don't even think everybody's feeling it at this point in the loud crowd and everything going on. I saw the moment that you're talking about the ref, I like looked down for half a second, looked up, and I was like, what am I saying to the ref? Because I don't honestly don't remember.
It's all over. Billy, you're gonna call your last timeout now. You're gonna stop the clock at 3 minutes and 20 seconds. The score is 123-111. Do you remember what specifically you were discussing during the timeout or what the strategy was going in here? I'll throw it to you, Diva.
I think it's just basically we were trying to rest because we were kind of, you know, our packs were going back and forth. And I think that they were going to switch it up. I don't know if this is the spot where they end up putting me back out again. I think they were just trying to utilize and rest, just like what Montreal was doing, trying to, you know, because the jams have been lasting for almost 2 minutes, some of them. So
yeah, that's a really good point.
You know, try and stop the clock here too, just since it is a pretty close score and we're getting to the last couple minutes.
Yeah, see, yeah, they put me back out there.
That's a good point too. I mean, in the beginning of the first half, the very start of this game, very long jams in general. It was a really low jam, you know, count, and we're all just now reaching jam 20 with 3 minutes remaining in the second half. So yeah, you're right. I mean, everybody was just doing some, you know, groundbreaking work, just driving it out, and you had to jam here, Diva. So 12 point game here at this moment, and you're gonna do the nice hit it and quit it moment. Yeah, so good call on both sides there, just trying to play the clock as best as possible. I think we had a question in the chat, and it just I forgot about it because we're going to the replay now. So, all right. So, how's everybody feeling at this point? I'm going to throw it now to Bro. We haven't heard from you in a minute. I just want to know what your thoughts defensively for Montreal, because now we're worried a little bit about the penalties. Everybody's like at a 4 or 5 area at this point, some at 6. So, what's it like now for your bench?
I think, so we probably know it's maybe our line's last jam out there. And I think we're happy to be 4 of us. Like, so you see us, like, you know, everyone's touching. We're like trying to remind each other, probably, like, we know what to do. You know, Falcon's going to do her thing. We're probably, like, I think we're not comfortable at all. Like, I think we're nervous, but we're just focused on, like, 4 people out. This is great. Really being connected with each other. And it's nice that, like, our coach comes out, the jammer's in there. So, I mean, I'm sure we're so nervous, but, like, we did a lot of, like, searching of, like, what's our optimal game mode. And for us, it's, like, a little bit nervous, but, like, each other and, like, calm body language. So I think it's great knowing, like, how much is on the line, that we're, like, you can see that we look, like, relaxed enough for the moment. So it's, like, it's good. I think we, like, learned how to help each other, like, bring our energy down. And I can't imagine we're not, like, completely nervous here, but it's nice to see that, like, the poise we worked on is, like, happening at, like, the highest, well, pretty high stake moment. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's a fair point. I mean, one of the biggest questions everybody's going through everybody's mind at this point is, where did Montreal get those cool shirts that light up? Because that's obviously a strategic one here. I'll throw it to you, Pat. Where did you guys get all these awesome shirts?
I think we got them from one of our awesome sponsors, Lola. I think those were kind of a surprise for the team / a gift from Cheese to Cheese and Mounge, who run Lola to the Cheese. It's kind of like an inside joke / mantra. Arkham says it a lot. Was the kind of the head coach, and so we made this plan to make these cool shirts. I think it was for props. You two can correct me if I'm wrong. And we kind of busted them out again for jams. We discussed matching up our t-shirts, our various black t-shirts for the games.
Yeah, Cheese was really excited. Low Life, MTL, and giving hearts all in that artwork by Biggley. So that's why you got that big smile on your face. It's interesting because you have that mentality going on the track, like keeping it cool. And it seems to, like, specifically at this point, we are under 2 minutes. We're at the last minute here, 127 to 115. Everybody's trying to keep their cool. But Diva, you had to jam, and you've been, like, skating almost this entire game. What is going through your mind? Are you feeling cool? Because I don't think I would be able to feel cool at this point.
It's weird watching this right here. I'm like, I know that watching the video, I'm so tired right there, but like right now I am not moving my feet. Like, what am I doing? My Biggie's out there and she's coding me with a smile. I don't know. I think I'm very, very proud. We came a long ways this season, from being 22 to moving up to 8th, 9th in the rankings. It was a fight. That was my first felony, and I had to go to the box and you know, almost had a perfect game for a first time in history. but yeah, it was hard that last jam.
Girl, but you killed it that entire game, like nonstop. You blocked, you jammed, you did it all. Like, and not just like once or twice. It's like they threw you out so many damn times. No wonder why you're tired. Like, hell, like I would have been done after one jam, you know? Like, you should be so, so, so proud of me. All Philly, that was an amazing game. It was so fun to watch. It was so fun to play. Like, it couldn't have been a better game.
Yeah, and I just want to add, like, there's a moment I noticed during that jam where you see both Diva and Falcon are, like, in a tripod and pushing, and no one appears to be moving. And you know how strong both of those jammers are. It speaks to, like, the level of grind defense that was happening in this game, that they're just, like, jammers are just appear to be leaning on blockers and no one's moving at all on the track.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It got really hardcore at that point. And Philly... you asked for the official review. Pat, I don't know if you remember, or maybe Diva, if you can recall what it was for.
I'm afraid I don't.
No, okay. Yeah.
I think
stop the clock. Yeah, but I don't know. She's out there, so he must have been talking about something.
Yeah, I don't think they, he didn't take a time. He just used it as a timeout. Just brought something up.
Okay. Does he, see, is he where he was wearing the wrong jersey?
He has on an Eagles jersey.
And you'll also notice that Diva is back out. You champion.
Wow. So if, and then, like, I don't understand, like, if I was, how did I have, even have energy to go back out if I was tired in the last game?
I don't know. Just, like, unruly. It's so wild.
But I went to the box because I was probably tired.
No, there you are.
Yeah. Okay. Reptar, you kind of like go through this jam here? Let us know what you're thinking here at this point.
I mean, now it's over. But in the beginning, you just have to try to not get ramped up in the fact that it's the final jam and just think of it like you're trying to win the jam and get lead like any other one. But I mean, Whips had a game and she was on it. So,
yeah.
Yeah, I think coming to a close here, Whips, you know, calling out the jam with like such fervor, I just thought like I was tired having just watched this. So you all are able to do this on the regular, but that was fantastic. You know, it ended up being a final of 135-115. But the score didn't really reflect how many times it went back and forth and how hard like everyone was hitting and like grinding this one. So it was like one of the best games. I just had to make sure that we got together and talked about it. I'd love to know what your closing thoughts are right now, because, you know, Philly, you had so much to be proud of, and Montreal, you hosted such a great tournament, and also, you know, you had such a great crowd experience and just awesomeness all around. So we'll just go around the room and just have maybe some final closing thoughts. We'll start with you, Jails.
Yeah. I mean, we hosted champs, I think a couple, like 2 years ago, maybe. And, you know, we weren't even playing and we know how hard it is to pull off. So I can't even imagine for Montreal, like, being able to host a tournament, play, and then have one of the final games and have it be that much, like, that close and exciting of a game. Kudos to Montreal and your league, because we know how hard that can be. But yeah, I don't know. It was really fun. It was my first champs ever, besides the one that I worked, and I don't really remember that one. And we know, like, every time we play Montreal, we know it's going to be a really good game. So, sorry, I don't totally remember the question you asked me, but it was very exciting. And I think, you know, like, ending on such a high note, it was a really good weekend for us. We worked super hard, and I think, you know, we were really proud of what we were able to pull off.
Oh, thank you so much, JB. Diva, any closing thoughts or remarks?
I think it's just that we were so, like, we worked hard to get the spot. And I think there was only 5 of our skaters on the roster that ever played in a championship game. So we like actually, you know, all these new skaters got a chance. Like we had Meryl, she's been on the team since 2014. She's like, I haven't played at champs. And like, and I'm like, a lot of our skaters, I'm like, if we make it a chance, and we did, I'm like, are they all going to retire? But it looks like we all get it right now. But, yeah, so I mean, like, it was just an honor to have the opportunity to get our team there to play, because a lot of skaters never had that chance. And I said it before, from going 22 in the rankings, 8th and 9th, and then coming to champs, like, I really wanted to see what we could have did this year. And hopefully we'll still have the opportunity to show what Philly is all about.
Thank you, Diva. And then kicking it back to you now, Reptar.
Kind of similar feelings. Is just like, no matter what happened at the end of this game, it was just an overall feeling of just being so proud of this team in general, and just coming so strong in this game and all the games prior. It just felt like every game through the whole season was just like, the ceiling just kept getting higher and higher, that we hadn't reached our ceiling. It's just like, oh, we're going to do this. We're going to, you know, like in the beginning, it was like, oh, we're rising in the rankings. And it was like, oh shit, we're going to go to champs. And it was like, oh, we're winning the first round of champs. And it was like, oh, we're in this game. So it was like, no matter what we finished out this game, it was just like, I was so proud to be out there with these people and do such crazy feats that we all did together.
That's wonderful. Yeah, we have just a little bit more remarks from our chat room. You know, Magna PEI said, you know, Philly were amazing to play. Cheese wants to take, just to come back to that. Take me back, she's yelling. Winter is coming, is saying, so glad to check on our twin all this Saturday afternoon, because even if it was just the last 15 minutes, that game was just amazing. And, you know, everybody loves reliving that game specifically. And also that Diva being back on Philly seems right to her. So thank you for that. Thank you, Philly. And then we're going to kick it to Montreal now. What were your closing thoughts and comments going to this, Biggley?
Well, I just wanted to say to Philly, first off, like, it was amazing watching your season, like, mind blown. Congratulations. That was a massive, massive season, a huge change. Y'all super proud of that. Also, it's like really exciting that we're getting more depth to the East Coast as well. So, you know, like there's been a little bit off shift for a bit, you know, so it's really nice to see that we have that building up. So that's always welcome. I love playing y'all. Like, it was amazing. So much fun the entire time. Like, I will always enjoy playing you, because it's just like so challenging, like regardless of who's wins, you know, it's always going to be a good game. And I'm super proud of the Skids. Like, we worked super hard on so many things, like especially closing games. Like, that was a challenge for us, is closing those damn games. And we're growing. So the work that we're in, I'm excited to hopefully get back to the track sooner than later, y'all. but couldn't be prouder of roller derby in general. So good.
Thank you for that. And Pat?
Yeah, it was just kind of a wild sensation. I mean, the first time I ever attended champs was as a spectator in 2009, and Philly was hosting. And then to have Montreal hosting when we were my first year on the bench, it just kind of felt a lot like full circle. And I think it's just a good feeling, because in my opinion, both teams had their best season in probably ever. And both games we played each other were really good games. And I think we kind of, some of us shared some laughs after that, like, oh, you know, just keep it going, like, better game each time we play. And yeah, so it was a really good way to close the season. And I feel like everyone on Philly and everyone on Montreal should be super proud of their season and this game and of their champs. I guess just like a shout out to our league for doing an awesome job of hosting.
100%.
Yeah.
200.
Thank you so much. And then finally, bro.
Yeah, so well, Biggley and Pat took a lot of what I was going to say. So we worked a lot on like looking at opponents not as like people that are against you, but like good opponents will like raise you to your best. And so I think Philly like challenged us to like, that's what you want. You don't want an easy game. You don't want a game that you're by 50 and you keep it. Like for us, it was challenging because we were down, had penalties, you know, they threw a wrench, like throwing D.Va on the track. We're like, oh, we're not prepared, even though we knew it could happen. So I think like kudos to, that's why it's such a good game, because we brought each other up. So I think that's to me what sport is about. And then, yeah, having our league behind us, like we were super lucky as Skids to not have to put in a lot of hours, except for people who worked at Low Life. But we were able to, you know, focus on playing because our league is so strong and they're so great. And like, we can never really say thank you enough to how hard they worked. And like, Philly knows. I remember when you hosted too, I like a lot of the players who we played against, like knew exactly what that was like. And then finally, like, I was so proud of the Skids, like all season. I remember like after the game when we kind of met, like the score didn't matter. It just mattered like how much like love and pride we had for each other. And like, regardless of who was on the track, who was like not rostered for the game, like people just, like we were super emotional because we were so proud of each other. Like we all tried to keep everything in. And then after, your emotions just like flood out, right? And like, you're so, like everybody shouting each other out. And like, that's what I remember. Like I remember the game, but the strongest memories are like coming together after and just, oh, I love you. Like, I love all of you because we like care about this sport so much. We care about putting so much into it. And like, we just did something that like everybody who played, everyone, and like during that, we can be really proud that we did it. And yeah, it was amazing. I don't even think I've processed champs because it's so, you're so tired after that. Like, I haven't even watched the games and now I'm excited. Now I'm like, oh, like, it's hard now to even think about all your emotions because you go through a million things over a weekend. And yeah, it was really special. So obviously thanks to Phil. And thank you for putting this on, because now I miss Derby even more, but that's okay. We love it, so we miss it, so.
That's so true. Thank you so much, Montreal. Thank you so much, Philly, for being part of this awesome experience and reliving this. And I hope soon that we can be doing this next year, talking about 2020 season. Both of you have been fantastic guests, so thank you again for being part of this. All right, thank you everybody at home.
Thank you.
You're awesome. Thank you everybody joining us on a live inside look at Montreal versus Philly. As they sign off, this was game 11 of the 2019 International WFTDA Championships that was held in Montreal, Canada last year. And if you've enjoyed watching Philly and Montreal commenting with us, be sure to check out all their social media channels to just kind of relive some of their postseason reactions and to what happened during our live connection here. And also, you know, we host these live shows on twitch.tv/WFTDA, and you can find them on our YouTube channel later on as well. So be sure to follow us on Twitch to be alerted every time we go live, and subscribe to our YouTube to see all the content that we publish. And if there's anything that you would like to see featured on an future episode of Upon Review, just let us know in our Twitch feed, as well as a comment on YouTube. We'll check those frequently to get them back. And so thanks again to Philly Roller Derby, the Liberty Bells, and Montreal's new Skits on the Block for opening up their derby world to us and their views on the game. And just remember that there's so much more for us all to learn in a derby community Upon Review. So I've been your host, Chloroform Cupcake, and I hope to see you again next time. Thanks.